Yes, thank you. So it's a great pleasure to be here. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me. And in this talk, I would like to give a brief overview of some recent developments in this area, which is roughly referred to as entanglement, holography, and geometry. But I will start this talk by saying a few things about the quantum mechanical notion of entanglement. Because that's going to play an important role, and entanglement, although it's a very well-known feature of quantum mechanics, it's starting to play a more and more important role in our present understanding of quantum gravity and the emergence of space and time. So I'm going to try to say a little bit of how this relationship between entanglement and quantum gravity and space and time comes about. I will review a few basic features of entanglement. Now, entanglement is exactly that thing that makes quantum mechanics different from classical mechanics. In quantum mechanics, you can do things that are not allowed in classical mechanics, and the reason that's possible is because there exists something called entanglement. And the most famous example of an entangled state is this EPR pair, this Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen pair, where you see a linear superposition of two states, and each state contains a system of two spins, and in one case one spin is up and the other is down, and in the other case it's the other way around. And obviously if you make a measurement of one spin in the system, you immediately know that if you afterwards measure the other spin, the result will be opposite. This is an entangled system. That means that if you have entanglement, that there are going to be correlations between the outcomes of measurements. Even if these measurements take place in an acausal way, so they can take place roughly simultaneously at different points in the universe, light years away from each other. But you know that if this was the initial state of the system, that the outcomes that you get will be correlated in a particular way. And that is something that in classical physics is impossible. If you make measurements that are acausal, the outcomes are always completely uncorrelated. So that's the main reason why entanglement and quantum mechanics are so different from classical mechanics. Now, it's nice to have some sort of measure for the amount of quantum entanglement between two quantum mechanical systems. So there is a notion which is called entanglement entropy, which is for some reason a useful quantity, which tries to give us a quantitative measure of the amount of quantum entanglement between a system A and a system B. And roughly speaking, what it is the number of EPR pairs, right, this was an EPR pair, is the number of maximally entangled pairs of states between the system A and B. And the mathematical definition of this quantity is slightly involved, but let me give it anyway. So if you start with a state rho on a Hilbert space H, which is the tensor product of a Hilbert space A and a Hilbert space B, so A and B are two disjoint subsystems of the full system, then what the entanglement entropy is, it's defined as minus the trace of rho A log rho A, where rho A is what we call the reduced density matrix, and it's obtained by taking the full state on the full system and by expanding it in the basis of states and by tracing away the states in subsystem B. You can see here that the two indices in the B system are equal. And this reduced density matrix in general is a useful notion because if I have a state on a combined A-B system and all I'm interested in is doing measurements only in subsystem A, then all the outcomes of those measurements can be reproduced by this reduced density matrix rho A. In other words, if I take a state rho on this tensor product and I take some operator in A times the identity operator in B, and I compute this expectation value, it's exactly the same as computing the expectation value of the operator in A in this reduced density matrix. So as long as I restrict measurements to subsystems, by taking this reduced density matrix, you can always reproduce all the outcomes. So this is the relevant amount of information in rho, as long as I look only at the subsystem. Now this quantity minus trace rho A log rho A, it's some sort of number. And if you compute it in an example, for example in this EPR pair, and you go through the steps, you first compute a reduced density matrix. It's just a 2x2 matrix with two diagonal entries 1/2. And if your matrix rho A is diagonal, this minus trace here, it simply becomes a minus, a sum over all the eigenvalues of eigenvalue times the log of the eigenvalue. So if you plug that in here, you get minus 1/2 log 1/2, minus 1/2 log 1/2, and that is log 2. And similarly, if you take n of these EPR pairs and you compute entanglement entropy, you get n times log 2. So in that sense, entanglement entropy is some sort of measure for the number of EPR pairs. What you can also see is that if you start to have a state rho which does not have any entanglement whatsoever, so it's a product state, a state on A times a state on B, then the eigenvalues of this rho A are very simple. It has one eigenvalue 1 and all the other eigenvalues are 0, because rho A now will be just a pure state, because my initial state was a tensor product state. And if you have one eigenvalue 1 and all the others are 0, then the entanglement entropy is 0. And indeed, a product state does not have any correlations in it. Entanglement entropy is an example of a quantity which is part of this field called quantum information theory. And quantum information theory is a very interesting field. It has many different things. But one of the things it does is try to sort of develop all kinds of notions of entropy for quantum systems, all kinds of other notions, and it tells us what these things mean, how to interpret them, and how to use them. And in quantum information theory, the most important application is to things like quantum computing, quantum algorithms, complexity of algorithms, and so on. But for example, the interpretation of this quantity, this entanglement entropy, in some sense dates back to classical information theory. Because if you write this in terms of eigenvalues pi, then we get this expression minus some pi log pi. And that's in fact an expression that was invented decades ago by Shannon in a very interesting paper on classical information theory. And it looks like a very strange number, but you can write it in terms of a generalized binomial coefficient. And if you think about what's standing here, this is really the combinatorial factor which is relevant if you have, say, a jar with colored balls, and a fraction p1 of those balls has color 1, and the fraction p2 has color 2, etc. Now this is roughly the number of different ways in which you can choose colored balls. And if you then take the large n limit and take the log, then you precisely spit out this number SA here. So it tells you something about the amount of information that you have in a string of colored balls, if the probabilities of those colored balls are p1, p2, p3, etc. And it also tells you, in some sense, to what extent you can compress the information in the random string of colored balls. But this is a bit besides the point. You can also show that this entanglement entropy satisfies all kinds of interesting inequalities that are very important in quantum information theory. Right now, they don't seem to mean too much. A simple inequality, for example, is that the entanglement entropy of the union of two systems is always less or equal to the entanglement entropy of one subsystem plus that of the other subsystem. And the reason is that if you have an EPR pair between an outside system and an AB system, then the amount of entanglement can never exceed that of the entanglement with the subsystem A and the subsystem B. There could also be all kinds of other entanglement, but you can never get more than this. If you think about it. And these are very simple inequalities, at least they seem simple, and it turns out to be incredibly difficult to prove these. Even in a finite dimensional quantum mechanical system, where everything can be expressed in terms of finite matrices, you always think that any inequality that involves finite matrices should be easy to prove by hand, but it turns out that these inequalities are notoriously difficult to prove by hand. Especially the last one here, which is called strong subadditivity, which as it stands doesn't seem particularly intuitive. I'll, and I show these because I'll get back to them later. Now this was entanglement in quantum mechanics, but what we are more interested in is entanglement entropy in quantum field theory. And the typical situation in quantum field theory is to take a subsystem A, which is a spatial region, and its complement AC. And then the Hilbert space of the quantum field theory, it factorizes roughly in a tensor product of all the states localized in A times all the states localized in the complement of A. And that means that, for example, in the ground state of a quantum field theory, you can ask how much correlation there is between measurements in A and measurements in the complement of A. How much entanglement is there, even in a quantum field theory, between A and its complement. And what you would like to do is apply the definition I just showed you to this product decomposition, and just do the math and see what comes out. Turns out to be very difficult to do in quantum field theory. In particular, it turns out the result is always infinite. And we can get some intuition for the structure of entanglement in a quantum field theory by putting it on a lattice. So if you put quantum field theory on a lattice, which is here denoted by a bunch of balls connected with springs, where these springs are simply the two body interactions between this node here and this node here, then intuitively, the entanglement between the inside of A and the outside of A is only due to the interactions that cross the boundary between A and its complement. Those interactions here and this one here, they are the interactions that are relevant for correlations between the inside and the outside of A. And based on that, you expect that the amount of entanglement between A and the outside in the quantum field theory, at least in the ground state, is roughly equal to the number of springs, if you wish, that are cut by the boundary of A. Well, if the lattice spacing between these springs is little a, which is like a short distance regulator, then that predicts that the entanglement entropy will roughly scale like the area of capital A in units of the uniformly cut of little a. So it's interesting because this is an area law. Normally, if you use the word entropy, you think of an extensive quantity, something that scales with the volume. But entanglement entropy is quite a different beast. And in the ground state of quantum field theory, it scales with the area, not with the volume.
Capital D.
Sorry?
Capital D.
That's the number of space-time dimensions. Yeah, so it's the area as dimension D minus 2. If it's a D-dimensional quantum field theory. That's why you get these dimensions. Sorry, thanks. And another very interesting example of thinking about the quantum field theory in terms of entanglement is what you get when you go to accelerated observers. Suppose this is just a two-dimensional plane and I have drawn a light cone here. And suppose we have a uniformly accelerated observer. This is not supposed to be larger than this here, but anyway. Suppose you have a uniformly accelerated observer. Then it's well known that this observer measures an Unruh temperature. You always met, that's at least a theoretical prediction, it has not been observed yet. But it's the Unruh temperature. Every uniformly accelerated observer in empty space measures a finite temperature. And although that's usually not how it's being computed, this can be explained in terms of entanglement as follows. This observer here is, if you think about this curve here, this observer is causally disconnected at all times from the left side of the plane. There's no light ray that connects the left side of the plane to this uniformly accelerated observer. Therefore, in order to describe measurements made by this observer and all the physics done by this observer, we might as well trace over all the degrees of freedom on the left-hand side. Those are irrelevant degrees of freedom, as far as this observer is concerned. Now, what is the structure of the ground state of quantum field theory in terms of left degrees of freedom and right degrees of freedom? So this is an example of a tensor product decomposition, as I explained before. where the region A is the right-hand side of the plane, of the real line in this case, and A complement is the left part of the real line. Well, it turns out that if you do the decomposition, the ground state of Minkowski spacetime, in this case, if you decompose it into states that are localized on the left and states that are localized on the right, and you take this form here, it takes the form of a thermal state, where this energy E is the energy measured with respect to the Hamiltonian used by these accelerated observers. This accelerated observer, there's a corresponding Lorentz boost that generates this acceleration, and these E's here are the eigenvalues of this Lorentz boost generator. And E left is the eigenvalue of the left boost generator, and E right the eigenvalue of the right boost generator. And you can do a simple computation to show that this is the nature of the ground state of Minkowski spacetime. So this is a purely quantum mechanical property of the ground state of any quantum field theory. If you decompose it into, if you slice space into two halves, and you decompose the ground state into states on the right half and on the left half, this is the universal structure of the ground state. And in particular, since this observer here does not have any access to the left-hand side, this uniformly accelerated observer sees only the reduced density matrix, which is what you get by tracing this state over the left matrix elements. If you trace it over the left matrix elements, all that you're left with is a purely thermal state. And that purely thermal state is precisely the finite temperature Undrew state that this uniformly accelerated observer sees. So this is an explanation of the Undrew temperature in terms of entanglement. And to show that this is the proper decomposition of the ground state of Minkowski spacetime, the usual computation involves choices of bases and doing Vogel-Yubov transformations and so on. But there actually is a... A is the acceleration, the amount of acceleration of this observer. Here there is a T here, so if you want to do this slightly more precise, you have to put the right units everywhere. But if you put the right units in this state and translate it back to an observer that accelerates with constant acceleration A, then you find exactly that this T is what stands here. But you have to put the right units in. Let me maybe skip this in view of time, but very briefly, if you want to show, find this decomposition of the ground state in terms of matrix elements localized on the left and on the right, and you want to trace over the left, then what you're left with is you have to do a path integral over the Euclidean plane, where you basically cut the right-hand side of the real line, and you put different boundary conditions just above and just below the right-hand side of the real line. And those matrix elements give you precisely the reduced density matrix. But then you use the fact that since it's on the Euclidean plane, that there's a rotation generator that connects these two, and that therefore these matrix elements are precisely the matrix elements of the Euclidean rotation generator. And the Euclidean rotation generator is precisely the same as the Lorentzian boost generator. And if you put that all together, you immediately find that this reduced density matrix has a thermal form. But let me not go into too much detail because of time. Now, unfortunately, it's in general, in any quantum field theory, it's incredibly difficult to compute entanglement entropy. So why is it useful at all? Even in a free quantum field theory, it's a notoriously difficult thing to compute. Moreover, entanglement entropy is not an observable. You can't measure it. And the reason is that it's the only things that you can measure in quantum mechanics are things that are linear in the density matrix, like trace of rho times an operator. Those are the things we can measure. But trace rho log rho is not linear in rho. And since it's not linear in rho, it's not, strictly speaking, a quantum mechanical observable. You can try to come up with all kinds of alternative ways to experimentally access something like entanglement entropy, but technically speaking, it's not an observable. And since in physics, at the end, we only care about observables, you could ask who gives a damn about entangled entropy. Anyway, but it turns out to be a very useful theoretical diagnostic and a very useful theoretical tool in many ways. You can, for example, in condensed matter systems, use it to probe the nature of ground states. And in particular, you can study quantum critical points and quantum phase transitions very nicely using entanglement entropy. It also is a very useful thing if you're interested in finding ground states, for example, or spin change. It turns out that thinking about the way things are entangled and using entanglement entropy is very useful. But by far the most important application from my personal point of view is that it seems to play some sort of fundamental role in quantum gravity. And I will get back to that in a bit. So here's a few simple applications. If you have a 1 plus 1 dimensional conformal field theory, so a scale invariant theory, the ones that describe critical points and so on, then it turns out that there is a universal answer for entanglement entropy for an interval of length L, which takes this form. It's C over 3, where C is a number, it's called the central charge of the conformal field theory, times the log of the size of the interval divided by some UV cutoff. And this turns out to be a great way numerically to extract central charges of fixed points. So if you have a spin chain and you simulate it on the computer, you try to find the ground state of the system, and you know that in the thermodynamic limit you're supposed to get a scale invariant theory, then you just compute this quantity for finite interval sizes L, and you just take the log and you see if it grows linearly with some slope, and from the slope you can read off numerically what the central charge of the fixed point is. And that turns out to be numerically a very efficient way to find central charges of fixed points if what you have is a discrete spin change.
So what is the UV?
That's the UV cutoff. That's a UV, yeah. In the quantum field theory, it's always infinite unless you regulate the theory somehow. So you have to choose a regulator, a UV.
You have to regulate, but you don't need to
renormalize. No, it's crucial to not renormalize. You can speculate that there is a useful quantity that you could call renormalized entanglement entropy, but its physical meaning is not entirely clear. In analogy with quantum field theory, you could say I'm putting a regulator in, I get a bunch of divergences. Now maybe I can subtract all the divergences with local counter terms and I'm left with something finite. You could try to do all that, but it seems a strange procedure for entanglement entropy. And in particular, if you do that, all these inequalities that I wrote down, they will be violated. So all the quantum information theoretic properties that you have go down the drain once you subtract divergences. So what you need to do is somehow work with an explicit finite UV cutoff all along. And another quick example is if you look at entanglement entropy in 2 plus 1 dimensions, is that you find an interesting universal coefficient in it, which is called topological entanglement entropy, and which has been used by Kitav and Preskill and others to diagnose topological phases in 2 plus 1 dimensional quantum critical systems. And the general structure of entanglement entropy in a conformal field theory appears to be as follows. So interestingly enough, although we don't want to renormalize it, the structure of the divergences is very much as if it should be renormalized. Because in a conformal field theory, you can show that the general structure of entanglement entropy for, say, a ball of size little l, it's a bunch of divergent power law divergences, and then depending on whether you're in even or in odd dimensions, there's either a constant or a log. And again, just like in quantum field theory, the log here is related to some anomaly. The coefficient in front of it is always related to some sort of conformal anomaly. But interestingly, in all dimensions, the finite number that appears also has an interesting interpretation. It is something like a conformal anomaly, except that in all dimensions there is no conformal anomaly. However, there is something else. It's sometimes called F. And just like in even dimensions, we have a C theorem. In all dimensions, there's something called an F theorem. And it's always the same thing that appears. And you can show that these properties, for example, tend to be monotonic under RG flow and things like that. But this looks again like the structure of divergence in quantum field theory, and so yeah, it's a bit remarkable why that happens. And another application, for example, is as a theoretical diagnostic, you can use it to diagnose what happens if you do a quench. So you have a system, you perturb it locally or globally, you do something, you quench the system, and then you ask at a later time t what happens to entanglement entropy through an interval of size L at the time t. And if you plot that, you will find that the entanglement entropy increases as a function of time until at a given moment in time it reaches a thermal value, and then it remains constant. So by computing entanglement entropy, you see a thermalization process where you gradually build up entanglement entropy until it becomes a purely thermal answer and then it remains constant. And there's a nice underlying picture for this, because the time scale where this happens in this particular toy model is exactly half the size of the interval. So apparently in this particular example, what happens if you quench the system is that you emit perfectly entangled pairs of quasi particles with opposite speeds along the light cone. And if you then figure out, so these pairs, they're entangled. So if you have two of these entangled particles, if they're purely inside the interval L, they do not contribute to entanglement entropy. But one, if one is inside L and one is outside of L, they do contribute to the entanglement entropy. Because now there's an entangled pair, one is inside the interval, one is outside the interval. And if you wait exactly t is L over 2, just by looking at the picture, you can see that then you have built up the maximum amount of entanglement between the interval and the outside. You can do similar games. And for example, if you apply this in some sort of ABS-CFT context to a quench in QCD, like which might be relevant for the quark gluon plasma and so on, then you find, contrary to naive, weakly coupled expectations, that in a strongly coupled field theory, thermalization proceeds from the UV to the IR, as opposed to from the IR to the UV, which, as is often assumed in QCD. And there are many issues and subtleties of this, but this is an interesting conclusion that you can draw, and the diagnostic you use to figure this out is entanglement entropy as a function of time. So this was entanglement, now briefly holography. The only the things that I will want to need. So holography is the statement that in quantum gravity you can encode all the degrees of freedom of space-time on a screen of one dimension less. The intuition for this comes from the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy of a black hole, which is S is A over 4G with some constants there. And there are many reasons to believe that this is the actual microscopic entropy of a black hole. And this shows you that the entropy scales with the area and not with the volume. And this was one of these remarkable, weird things about black holes, is how can entropy scale with area and not with the volume? Because we know that entropy in a local quantum field theory is extensive. It scales with the volume, not with the area. So if you this weird behavior of the entropy gave rise to this idea of holography, namely that it should be able to encode all the information of this gravitational system in essentially a local system in one dimension less. Because if you could encode all the information of this system here in a local system in one dimension less, then the entropy that you would get from this local system in one dimension less would have exactly the right scaling to explain black hole entropy. And then you can do all kinds of heuristic Gedanken experiments to see whether this indeed can be made more precise, and indeed you can make it more precise. But one conclusion is that if, in general, in quantum gravity, the degrees of freedom don't scale with the volume, but scale with the area, that means that quantum gravity is something incredibly non-local. Because if it were a local theory, like a quantum field theory, and entropy should scale with volume, not with area. And also this reorganization of something in one dimension higher in terms of local degrees of freedom in one dimension less That is clearly a highly non-local thing to do. So the picture that one gets is that all these fundamental degrees of freedom of gravity therefore must be incredibly non-local. However, if you look at gravity, it seems like a perfectly local theory. So what we are right now, the picture that we have right now is that this standard local theory of gravity somehow emerges from this very complicated non-local mesh if we do something like a thermodynamic limit. And gravity is almost like hydrodynamic modes that are propagating on this incredibly complicated soup of highly non-local fundamental degrees of freedom. And it's only a few somehow light degrees of freedom that emerge. It's like in, if you sort of write down the effective theory of a fluid. And this is why we use the slogan that, gravity and space-time are emergent phenomena. They only arise after a suitable coarse graining of these of this horrible soup of complicated non-local degrees of freedom. And this analogy with thermodynamics and with the way, for example, a fluid emerges from its fundamental constituents is more accurate than you might think. Now, there is a very interesting tantalizing similarity between black hole entropy, which is A over 4G, and entanglement entropy, which also scales like the area over cutoff. And in particular, if you do the following computation, you take a black hole